Good evening. It has been another bad week. Ambulance men have refused to deal with emergencies. On the railways, our trains have been halted while trade union brother wrangles with trade union brother. On the roads, lorry drivers have continued to defy their union by mounting secondary pickets to stop essential supplies. And it is worth remembering that the latest wage round has only just begun. So have the unions too much power? Do they misuse the power they have got? Tonight, TVI has taken over the Hampstead Theatre and invited two trade unionists to face an invited audience of Conservative Party members from the London commuter belt. With me on the platform, Clive Jenkins of the Management Staffs Association and John Edmonds of the Municipal Workers Union. In front of me, Mrs. Thatcher's shock troops. Only shock troops who applaud themselves, but thank you very much. Let me start with Mr. Pears in the fourth row there, sir.
Well, many newspapers this morning carry the story of Dr. Patrick Chesterman, the Reading surgeon, who refused medical treatment at his clinic session to trade union members. Now, I don't necessarily agree with a piece of backlash action like that, but it's evident that very many ordinary people are being driven beyond the point of exasperation because the trade unions appear to be above the law. Now, do you two gentlemen not feel the country's got jolly good reason to feel that way?
Clive Jenkins.
Well, the consultant concerned, of course, is a trade unionist himself, isn't he? He's in the BMA, and I think that his right to belong to that...
No.
He's in the BMA, the BMA. Oh, you mean he's not in the BMA? You mean he doesn't sympathise with the BMA? How disgraceful.
Would you like to
what
answer the question,
what an act of anti-solidarity. Clive? I think we must not discriminate against people when they need help, at the point where they need help.
We all need help!
And I'd like to make a specific point. There are a number of people in our society who have a sensitive relation to the rest of us. I think that means people in the health service particularly. I think it means not just the consultants, but the ancillary staffs, the specialists who work looking after people in hospitals. And I don't think we should get them in a position where they have to have a dispute. I would like to have a very sensitive regard for relating their remuneration to what people get in the private sector. So I would like to take the National Health Service out of the hurly-burly of collective bargaining. Our problem is that they've fallen very badly behind, and it's a very severe problem for us.
Clive, can I bring John Edmonds in, please?
Yes, I agree with the difficulty that they have been really held back, and they've been held back because the community has counted on the fact that they will not exploit their sensitive position and hurt patients.
May I direct you to the question? Is there not likely to be a backlash? Whatever the rights or wrongs of individual claims, is there not likely to be a public backlash?
Yes, of course there's likely to be a public backlash. And I think if we continue to give publicity to these individual actions, they are likely to be emulated, as so many things that appear in the press are. But I'd like to make one point about this, you see. Someone in the front row drew the comparison with the blockade of certain supplies needed for cancer patients. And I think I ought to bring that in at this time. I think we ought to see what the union involved in that dispute has actually said to its members. It said, essential supplies which are important for the preservation of health should be let through.
Absolutely.
And it's the members of that union, the individual hospital workers who have reached such a state of exasperation that they will not obey their union's advice. And I think we ought to distinguish
quite clearly. Why don't you put your house in order?
Can I hear the gentleman? Well, gentleman up at the back there, let me hear from him, please. Yes, that's you, sir.
You have practically ruined British Leyland through the unions. You are putting the ratepayers to a great amount of money to keep British Leyland going through innumerable strikes that keep on going in British Leyland, costing the public hundreds of millions of pounds. Why is it we don't have no problems in private enterprise? Only because of the unions that you have exceeded exceeded, and you have been allowed by law, more or less, which is the government's, which has given you a free hand in doing whatever you wish to do.
Do you feel you can do whatever you wish to do, John Edmonds?
No, of course not, and that's why NUPE gave this advice to their members. And in fact, throughout the disputes that we've had in recent years, the union advice has been consistent on questions of the preservation of life and the preservation of property, but the emphasis is always on the preservation of life. Now, let's take that particular point about British Leyland, and free enterprise companies have no problem. If I remember rightly, British Leyland was a free enterprise company and had to be nationalised because there was no other way of preserving that company.
Can I add a word, please?
Very quick one, please,
Look,
Clive. I must
British
bring more people
Leyland
in.
Was brought into existence as a result
by
of
Harold Wilson.
No, nonsense, by Lord Stokes.
Now, group.
I wonder if you'd listen to me for a second. British Leyland, I think, should never have been brought into existence in the beginning. But it was done as a result of market pressures, and Lord Stokes and others thought it should be brought into existence. I think that was wrong. And because that capitalistic managerial decision was wrong, we've all had to bail it out. I think we should support it. But just look at Chrysler. Chrysler has collapsed.
Through the unions.
Nonsense. Shall I tell you why Chrysler's collapsed?
Every time.
No, I'm sorry.
Mr. Jenkins.
All and have one
all right, Mr.
Oh.
All of you, all
have
of you.
Union
all of you, please.
What illiteracy.
Mr. Jenkins.
Run my business, I'll be out of business.
Sir, you have had your turn. Let me now move on.
And
let us bury the car industry for a moment, and let us try and if it doesn't bury itself, let us try and get back to our point in hand, the power and strength of the unions. Let me have the lady in the front row here, this lady here.
Yes. Consultants and doctors are trained, but anyone unqualified can be employed in an ancillary capacity. Is it right that the trade unionists in hospitals should decide who lives or dies?
Mr. Edmonds.
It's obviously not right, and that's the reason why the advice is being given. I mean, I think Clive Jenkins has really answered this point. If you've got particular groups of people on whom society depends, then we should protect those groups of people. And we should not continue to challenge them, as we did with the firemen, as may be, although they're not a bona fide trade union, as we did with the police, until they get to a stage where they say, the only way we can get out of this difficulty is by a strike. Just the firemen's example. For years, the firemen have claimed that they have slipped behind the sort of position in earnings terms that their training and the dangers they have to face would justify. They argued, they negotiated, they pleaded, they lobbied Parliament, they did all the sensible, reasonable things that good Democrats are told to do, and they got very little. They threatened and then took strike action, and they now have the sort of protected earnings level that they've been fighting for 20 years. Now, if a society teaches people those sorts of lessons, and that's the society we've got, unfortunately, we end up with the sort of situation that is happening outside hospitals at the moment.
Thank you very much. Mrs. Langston in the front row.
It seems to me that secondary picketing is causing great alarm through the country, and it would appear that the trade union leaders have lost control over their members. Do you believe that the law should be changed to stop this sort of picketing?
Clive Jenkins.
I don't know what you mean by secondary picketing. Well, as I understand it, this is a seminar in industrial relations, so I'll explain it to you now. Because I think
will you do it quite quickly, Mr. Jenkins?
There is a very dangerous group of destructive agitators in this country. Let's accept that. They are the editors and columnists of our national newspapers.
Robbie!
Now, secondary picketing, it seems to me, is where you go to a company where black goods are being delivered. Now, this has happened for... where they come from a strike-bound plant, which is officially strike-bound. Large numbers of our fellow citizens. And I want to put you the proposition that most people who exercise most democratic decisions by voting themselves go to meetings. and they go to trade union meetings. And if anybody says now we'd like secret ballots, why not? But then, if you're going to have ballots, remember, it means that people will take longer to decide what they do about their strikes. Secondary picketing, where somebody intervenes into a situation where the other two parties are not in dispute, has occurred twice in this dispute.
Mr.
Twice.
King, Mr. King.
Twice.
I take Mr. King, please.
Well, yes. You tell me where it has happened.
All right, Mr.
Rubbish. Absolute rubbish.
Mr. King.
You're a Daily Telegraph reader.
Thank you.
Or Gene Rock.
Clive Jenkins.
Mr. Gardner, I'd like to ask Mr. Jenkins. I'm Nelson King, and I'm a Conservative European finance officer. And my question is, should there be key trade unions that sell out the right to strike for a reasonable indexed pay settlement, for example, the ambulance drivers?
I'm going to take a couple of questions and let you deal with two or three at a time now. Mr. Phillips in the front row, please.
In the UK, we've come to a ridiculous situation where the employers cannot, without a great deal of difficulty, sack a totally incompetent employee. Yet a union can, to all intents and purposes, fire an excellent employee simply by removing his union card. Would you not agree that it is high time the closed shop practices were revised so as at least to allow an employee to exercise his democratic right to go to work, even if he has to cross a picket line, now with Mr. Callaghan's own permission, without the very real threat of being expelled from his union and hence effectively fired?
Thank you very much. I'll take two more points and then go back to the platform. Gentleman there in the light brown suit, I'll get it out. Thank you very much.
Mr. Gardner, Mr. Jenkins, Mr. Edmonds, why should the public, including many loyal trade unionists, suffer when one gets into inter-union dispute, such as the rail strike, which is an ASLEF versus NUR conflict? Can't they devise a workable system whereby these differences, which will obviously occur, are sorted out without damaging a struggling and declining industry?
One more point from the audience. Gentlemen, lady back there, I'm so sorry, with the glasses, that's right.
I'm a manufacturer of small leather goods, and 90% of my goods go to export. I would like to ask you what you are doing about testing the opinion of the many thousands of people who work in small factories, many of whom are not in unions and don't want to strike. I employ 50 people. They don't want to strike. They tell me they want to work for Britain, not strike against it, and they've signed 50 of them to say that. And I want to make one other question, and that is to ask you, what do you propose doing about the small firms who need raw material supplies desperately? Also, many of them want to get their goods away for export, and they'll be forced to close, resulting in massive unemployment if this goes on. It is not only the hospitals that need help to get their supplies through, we all do. And you are striking against the lifeblood of England, and my workers believe in this, and they want to get back to work for England.
Thank you very much. I'll come to... Thank you very much. You are using your own time by clapping, however. John Edmonds, we've got the right to strike of essential workers, the closed shop, conflict between trade unions, and what about the smaller factories?
Yeah, my reaction is, how long have you got? Because if we're going to be asked to answer eight questions in three concise sentences, I'm afraid we're all going to be disappointed. Right, I will start answering, and I'll start with yours. OK? You were asking about the position of the closed shop, as I understand the question. If, as has happened in many, many industries, there is a negotiated closed shop agreement. And let's just be a little bit sensible and knowledgeable about the problems that we're discussing. We are not talking about imposed agreements. We are talking about closed shop agreements that have been signed by employers, where employers have taken on certain obligations. In almost every case, there are very sensible and extensive get-out clauses which allow people of conscience to contribute to a charity. I may say that in the many agreements that I've signed on closed shop, which allow people to avoid joining the union by contributing to charity, I say, and this may be unfortunate for many of you, very few charities have gained one penny as a result, Because when people are deprived of the financial advantage of staying outside trade unions, and the records are there, I'm afraid the answer usually is that they join the trade union and take the benefits. And they then sustain the argument that many other people have said all along, that the reason they want to stay out is not principle, but is to avoid paying the contribution, which is... Study the record. Study the record. There's recently been an agreement in these terms signed by the Greater London Council. I hope in 6 months' time they will publish the number of people out of that massive organisation who have contributed to charity rather than stay in a union. Thank and you. I think you will see from that that the figures I've given you and the impression I've given you is correct.
Clive Jenkins, would you like to deal with the right to strike of workers in essential services? Because it seemed to me, in a sense, at the beginning you were coming somewhere near that kind of argument when you were talking about hospital workers.
Well, what was said is that you might sell out the right to strike for an indexation agreement.
Yes.
Well, if people want to do that, why not? But I haven't known any group yet that wants to do it. I would like to have some means of, however, protecting people in these sensitive occupations. I think all of us have forced us into a situation, forced them into a situation, where they feel it's the only way to attract attention to their grievances. Now, I was mixed up in the hospital engineers dispute, and I found it absolutely excruciating. In the end, we settled it. But I must say that negotiating authorities dealt with it very badly indeed. What about inter-union disputes? I must say, I regret them. I regret inter-company disputes as well. And I want you to have a sensitive political appreciation of what it's like living in an industrial democratization. What we have is companies, remember, knock hell out of each other. Unions do as well. I would like us at a better and higher level of performance. And there is an inter-union problem on the railways. It doesn't depend upon unions, though. What you have is general workers, craft workers, managers, and they all feel they've got their own rights. And I don't doubt that all of you in managerial positions here feel you've got a position to defend in our society. And I doubt whether you would trade out your right to make gains, to advance and be paid for your effort, and then make a decision you wouldn't strike.
We're in grave danger.
Yes, let's take the gentleman there.
We're missing a very important point here. We had a very somber warning from the Governor of the Bank of England earlier this week.
Well, he's not much use.
That fiscal restraint and monetary policy must be adhered to. Now, I want
to hear... Why should you believe him?
I want to hear what the trade
union... Well, you're wrong all the
way through. Mr. Jenkins, please.
I want to hear what the trade union leadership thinks of the prospect of higher interest rates, higher overdrafts,
right,
higher mortgages as a direct consequence of the pursuit of excessive pay claims, and if not, where are they going to cut public spending to afford it?
Now, this really is the crudest of arguments. I've just walked last week through Wall Street looking at their problems and looking at their inflation rate on behalf of an independent committee. The governor and the Treasury told us last year that inflation would go into double figures if pay settlements did. Pay settlements did, inflation didn't. Why should you trust these faulty fortune tellers? You respect our establishment too much. You should be a better mathematician.
Mr. Edmonds, the Bank of England
is one of the few institutions I take out of public ownership.
Mr. Edmonds, please let me bring Mr. Edmonds. It's an important question, and let us hear Mr. Edmonds' answer on it as well, please.
I really think that when you're examining the various statements made by trade unionists in microscopic detail, you also might examine the predictions made from time to time by the Treasury and by the Bank of England. And you will find that they have been consistently wrong in the way that Clive Jenkins has just said. They have misstated the rate of inflation with amazing regularity.
Yes.
And they have been wrong consistently about the causes of inflation.
Mr. Edmonds, I must ask you, are you telling us that that increased wages and wages over the limit set by the Chancellor are in themselves not inflationary?
Yes.
I think that the present... Let me answer it this way. The government chose a 5% limit and it misread the feelings of working people in this country. The result was that because members of unions were not satisfied with 5%, and remember, this was a groundswell of opinion in Ford's, in the lorry drivers' dispute, in each case, the members of those unions made it absolutely clear that they were not prepared to accept offers within the guidelines before the unions took action. Because of that, we got into what seems to me a stupid virility game where unions had to break through the 5% in order to maintain any credibility with their members. And the unfortunate thing is that when governments erect these barriers and they say these barriers are all important and no other policy is sensible, when the barrier goes, then there is no pretense of an effective policy below.
Thank you very much. Mr. Rathbone there. Gentleman there.
I'd like to take up a point that was made by a gentleman in the front row there a few minutes ago. A trade union will often act instantly and ruthlessly to deprive a member of his union card and thus of his livelihood for example, working during a strike or handling so-called black goods or something of that kind, when that same union will show itself gutless and flabby when dealing with those of its members who go on unofficial strike against the advice of the union.
Clive Jenkins.
Well, I would have thought that...
He wants to make another point, Clive. Can you make it quickly, Mr. Rathbone,
yes,
please?
Yes, certainly. If the trade union leadership is genuine in its expressed wish that picketing should be lawfully conducted, and that means, of course, limited to peaceful persuasion and communication of information, why does it allow and indeed encourage mass picketing, often by people who have nothing whatever to do with the dispute, and has the effect of intimidation by sheer numbers?
Now, I'm not aware there's been any mass picketing in any of the disputes we've had at the moment.
Right.
Oh, I see. So we're going back to Saltley.
Yes.
Grunwick, there was mass picketing. I think the Grunwick management is a disgrace to all of us.
Never mind that.
Let us not have an argument about Grunwick. Let us answer this particular point.
I believe that picketing ought to be carried out by the people involved in the dispute. Yeah. Let's say that flatly. Right. But then, I don't know how many people in this audience would then support that. And I want to put it bluntly, I don't want any bloodlust here tonight.
We
I would hope that...
Let the silent majority speak.
The silent majority speaks through the
let
voice of the proprieties of newspapers. I doubt if you're an adequate spokesman for the silent majority. You're rather shrill, aren't you?
Can I go back
to picketing?
Very quickly,
Picketing ought to be done by the people concerned. And I think that's very important. And I despise the Trotskyist extremists who actually get involved. And I don't want you now, at the same time, to condemn unions seeking to deal with this problem in that way. I want to go back to small firms briefly. I have supported the cause of small firms because I think with the new technology, they may be the way of providing jobs in a labor-intensive way. And I must say, on Sir Harold Wilson's committee, as you know, we'll get a report helping the small firms. So I don't want you to think that some of us don't have a very sensitive appreciation.
Right. I do want to put a question of my own to you both to end the programme, if you both give me fairly short, sharp answers on it, but I think it's a question that worries a lot of people. That we heard a lot over the last four years or so of the special relationship that exists between this Labour government and the trade union movement. Does that special relationship still exist? And if it does exist, isn't it now in danger of falling apart, and aren't you in danger of, in fact, bringing your own Labour government down? Clive Jenkins first.
Yes, it does exist. But the problems of managing... Well, it wouldn't exist with the Conservatives. Why don't you hear me say that? I'll say it now. The problems...
Are you saying you can't work with the Conservatives?
I think the Conservatives don't understand the problems. In fact, I am convinced the Conservatives don't understand that there will be no possibility in our rich and complicated society of incomes policies ever working.
Right.
But I tell you what I like, shall I? I
want
people,
John's time.
I want people used in their work and paid as a result of merit and energy and distinction. I don't think the Conservatives would pay anybody except in
proper washrooms. You have 15 seconds, John.
When I get worried about the relationship between the unions and the Labour Party, The only thing that restores my faith in that relationship is taking a good hard look at the Conservative Party. Thank you.
Thank you all. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you all very much for joining us tonight. Thank you on the platform for joining us and coming into the Lion's Den. From TVI, good night.